put on this computer.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Thanks.
So taste and see that the Lord is good. And this is my prayer during the next 8 weeks, that we will taste and see that the Lord is good. And the word Lord here is Yahweh, some say Jehovah. It's Yod-Heh-Vah-Heh in Hebrew, the consonants. That's how you pronounce the consonants. And we'll look at that name in week 6. And the word good here, this good in Hebrew is tov, and that is my absolute favorite Hebrew word. It means good, pleasing, favorable, better than anything. So this is what we're going to do for the next 8 weeks, is to taste and see that Yahweh is tov. The way the study started out was that I love Hebrew, biblical Hebrew, and I wanted to learn more about God and his Hebrew names. So I started a personal study on the first 7 names of God as they were revealed in the Bible in order. It started out as just an intellectual study, but it turned into basically a personal revival for me. And I actually learned more about God from this little study than I had in years. I had a new knowledge of who God is through his names, and that increased my faith and trust in him because I knew more of who he was. And I started using his names in prayer, which even reinforced it even more. And then I shared this study with a group of girls in my church, and then God led me to put it into print. So on page 6, my first question in the study to you is, what is your image of God? Who is God to you? So did anyone have a think about what the image of God is? A couple of people share what your image of God is, or how it's changed over the years, what it started out to be.
Go ahead, Jim.
I mean, has he always been a loving father to you as an image?
I think as I've matured in my faith, God has gone from being the God that's way up there, wherever there is, to where God is right here with me.
Mm.
So my image of him is that he is with me along my way.
Mm.
I don't see him as a God way over there anymore, or way up there.
That's good.
Is that kind of what you're...
Yeah, you know, that's good. And then Kimmy Sue said, my image of God is as described in Revelation, how he looks as in physical appearance. Mm. And Carol said, my first image of God was someone waiting to zap me when I did something wrong. Thank goodness I've learned he is so different. Yeah, I think a lot of people think like that, that he's just waiting like a grumpy school teacher, just waiting for you to do something naughty and give you a rap over the knuckles.
The last 3 or 4 years, I've learned that, you know, that we're made in the image of God. You know, most people know that from the scripture. You're made in the image of God. But it's not just that. We're made to be imagers of God.
Mm.
I mean, the Hebrew literally brings that up, that we're made to be imagers of God. And that opens up a whole new understanding of a lot of stuff in the scripture. Mm.
That's so true. I viewed God more as an
because in growing up, you know.
Go ahead, Jim.
I'm sorry, my internet tells me mine's not working. Oh, there it goes. In growing up, we see all the pictures that are drawn of Jesus. And of course, that's our connection to God in thinking about that, but they're all white with beards and blue eyes. And, you know, I'm like Dale, in the last few years, when I look at any of you, I should see God.
Mm. That's good. Yeah, I had a distorted view that he was an exam, an examiner. Like I had to, I'm sitting down in a chair taking an exam, and he's taking my paper and marking it. That's what I had. it might have been my strict church background when I was younger, but he's been renewing it to more of a father, an Abba father. So that's good. Let me change this. So to get a new image of God, we have to do something that Romans 12, 2, Dale's favorite verse. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And I have found since doing this study that one of the best ways to renew our minds so that we can relate more to God is to know his names. And when you do that, you actually know who you're praying to, and it increases your faith. So I'm turning to the next slide. And in the book, we talk about the significance of names, and we compare modern times to ancient times, because when we think of names, we mainly choose our children's names on how the name sounds. And some cultures, names have quite an importance.
I'm very sensitive about this, because as you can see, my name is Dale Moore, which means I am low swamp land.
Is that what it means? Wonder,
well, a dale, a valley in the dale, is a dale, and a moor is a moor, a swamp land. I mean, I'm thinking, what was my mom thinking? Huh?
Well, just think, swamp land is very fertile.
Oh, now, there you go. Bring me some spiritualization.
Very fertile ground. I need it. It may be under the water, but it's very fertile.
That's it.
Well, you know what mine means, don't you, Rachel? It means an old sheep, mother sheep. But I like to think Jesus is my good shepherd, and I'm the sheep following him.
There you go.
But I'm very interested in Tomoko's name, because it's very unusual to me. I'd love to know what that means.
You're muted.
That is a Japanese name. I was made in Japan, and it means wealth and fortune.
Oh, wow. Very cool. Did anyone else want to share what their name means?
My name is the feminine form of Jonathan, so it's gracious gift of God.
Yeah. Two of my sons have the same meaning. Sean and Nathan both mean gift of God.
Yeah.
Mm. I'm not following the chat. Sorry. Kimmy,
I did not know that.
Sorry, Jim.
I didn't know that Sean was a form of Jonathan, and our son is named Jonathan.
Hmm. Sean and Nathan is a form of Jonathan. Kimmy Sue said, thinking about it, God is the overall authoritative figure, the final judge, and a bit scary. A picture of the Son is a loving kindness version of God. Yep. And the sad thing with our English Bible is that God's name is God, capital God, Lord, or capital Lord. And we've sort of left out the beauty of the Hebrew, really, which is a bit of a shame. But we can learn what's behind the names. And in ancient times, your name was your reputation. Proverbs 22:1 says, a good name is to be chosen rather than great riches. And the name there in Hebrew is translated as reputation. So in ancient times, your name revealed your reputation. And then I had this, I included the story of 1 Samuel 25, just illustrating this, about David meeting Nabal and Abigail. So what was Nabal like?
Ooh. As his name.
Ooh, folly.
Yeah.
I like how you wrote foolishness oozes out of him.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a really good word picture.
He was badly behaved. And then Abigail, did anyone find out about Abigail's name, what that meant? It means father of joy, source of joy. And the story went that David was in the area where these guys lived, and he sent 10 of his men to ask for provisions. In the past, they had protected all their shepherds. And, you know, he was just asking them for some food. But Nabal said nope. So David got a bit upset about that and was going to take his men, a lot of them, 400 men, with swords and fight him. But Abigail, isn't she amazing? She found out and went on behalf of her husband to ask David not to do that. And she said in verse 25, let not my Lord regard this worthless fellow, Nabal, for as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name and folly is with him. So I don't know, maybe when the parents named him, it was like a prophecy or prediction, but that's pretty sad that you're going around with a name like that. The Hebrew word name is Shem, which means a mark or memorial of an individual. And it was a sign of authority to name a person. What was the end of that story? What happened to Nabal?
God struck his heart as stone, I think, is the way it was described.
Yeah.
And he laid there for 10 days and he finally died. Then David says, hey, go back there and get that wife. I liked her. I want to add her. I think she became wife number 6.
Okay.
Or something like that.
Yeah, I don't like the idea of him having more than one wife, but.
Well, he did.
Yeah.
Well, at least he wasn't like Solomon.
Oh, I know. I can't get my head around all that. Okay. And then I mentioned that God changed people's names in Genesis 17. And we had Abram, which means high exalted father, whose name was changed to Abraham by God, which means father of multitude. And then we had Sarai, which means princess, changed to Sarah, which means mother of nations. The meanings of their names are quite close.
Yeah.
But what was changed was the ha sound.
Yeah, where'd that come from?
Well, ha, ruach, is the name for breath or spirit. And it's the same as Yahweh. It's got a ha in there in the middle.
Yeah, it's Yah, Y-A-H, that part of Yahweh. Yeah. God put his name in the middle of their names.
Which is pretty awesome.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yeah. So, I mean, names are really up there as pretty important and precious in God's name, in God's eyes. And then I mentioned Revelations 2, verses 17. And God will change our names. We don't know what it's going to be, but it's on a rock with hidden manna on a white stone. Wow.
Yeah, what is that all about?
Yeah, don't know. We won't know till we're there, do we? It says, I'll give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. Yeah. Oh, who will get a new name? The one who conquers. I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. What I found about every time God revealed a new name, it was in response to help his people. So they had something to hold on to, which is pretty awesome. they say that his names are like a diamond, that as you turn it and the light sparkles and reflects, you can see different hues. So each name that he reveals paints a picture in words of what he's like and how he relates to us personally, individually. Now, this is the key verse for the whole study. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run to it and are safe. So what does this verse tell us about God's name and us?
We're supposed to run to him in our time of need, and he will make us safe.
So who are the righteous?
Me.
The ones who run to him.
Yeah.
It tells us what the name is, that the Lord is a strong tower. I liked what you said about that. Something about a place of safety or a place that you run to. Is that what you said?
Yeah. Strong tower in Hebrew is Migdal Oz, which is an immensely fortified tower.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
That you can run to that. And the overall thing of how God chose to reveal his character and nature and who he is by his name.
Mm.
Yeah, that's intriguing. So he's a strong tower, not a weak tower, a strong tower.
Yeah.
There's so much there, you know?
Yeah. And the run in Hebrew is rutz, just a rush. It's the image of a person with an important message running rapidly to deliver it. So we're not just walking or, you know, going slowly to him in times of trouble. We're rushing there, running there. I used to stumble over the word righteous because growing up, I felt that only if you were totally perfect and clear, like, you know, you hadn't sinned today, that you could run to God, which, you know, it's completely not true, because before we even were born, he loved us and died for us. So before we could even do anything good or bad, he loved us. So it's not just.
Isn't that the time I need to run to him? Is when I've done something bad. Like
exactly. That. I know it's not very good thinking what I had been brought up with.
Seriously, I know we've all been there.
Yeah. So yeah, this is a really good verse to memorize, actually, to remember in times of anxiety. And then I had another key verse, Psalm 9, verse 10. And those who know your name and put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. So this tells us why we learn God's names. What does it say?
Let me out. I'm stuck in your pocket. Let me out.
What does this verse say about why we learn God's names? So that we can put, so it increases our trust, put their trust in you. And I found that to be true, that the more I know about his different names, the more my trust in him increases. And that on that page, what page was that? Page 19, unless you're in the Kindle, there was a whole list of questions there. It's sort of like a mini test to reveal any lack of trust in God. So how did you guys go on that?
Yeah, that's where you started meddling some, right?
Did we worry about anything this week? Well, that's a lack of trust. Put my hand up. Any thoughts about how you're going to live in the future that weren't productive? There were more concerns. Worry about our children or grandchildren. Well, that comes with the territory, but we have to learn how to turn that worry into prayer and thanksgiving. health issues, even down to worrying about our clothes. Yeah, there's so many things that we can worry about, but we're not supposed to. I said the worry is the opposite of trusting. Right, now I want to look at these scriptures, seven scriptures that describe why God's names are so important. Let's just share about which of these scriptures really spoke to you and what did God say? Who wants to start? Should we look at the first one, Matthew 6:9? Our Father in heaven.
I find that one just foundational everything, because it's the model prayer, right? Jesus is saying, this is how you pray. And he starts off with what? Okay, here's who you pray to. Father, this is where he is. And this is what you're supposed to do. Hallow his name. That gives us some insight into what the significance, the importance of the name, you know?
Yeah. And being the first line in the Lord's Prayer, it's the first thing that he taught us. Holy be your name in my life. I don't know that we think about that enough, that our life is portraying him to others. So is his name being hallowed in our life? Anybody else got thoughts on Matthew 6?
Well, that's sort of convicting from the get-go. You know, that idea that when people look at your life and look at you, do they see God being hallowed?
Yeah. Because we're representing his name.
You know, one of the hardest things.
Go, Jim.
I think his interlinks are locking up on him.
My computer's doing. One of the hardest, one of the hardest things sometimes is remembering people's names. And especially as you get older, you come across somebody, you can't remember their name and they call you by name. One of my favorite songs is called He Knows My Name. And you know, we should worship God because he never forgets our name. He wrote it in the palm of his hand.
And then Psalm 52:9, I will thank you and confide in you forever because you have done it, delivered me and kept me safe. I will wait on hope on and expect in your name, for it is good in the presence of your saints. That's the Amplified. I like how they amplify and say, I will wait on hope in and expect in your name. It's good
forever. Yeah.
And because I did the study on the word good, tov, which actually means it's something that is functional, that works, it's operating and it works. So his name is functional and operating and it works. It's pretty cool. Did anyone want to talk about Psalm 52:9? Oh, Jan has put in the chat, I've found that his names are also his character, and it helps my trust in him to know that he can't be any other way than what his character or name is. For instance, his name Provider means I can trust him to provide because he can't not provide for me. That's what he is. Oh, yeah, that word Provider is amazing. We'll get to that. But knowing Jehovah Jireh as my provider is will revolutionize your prayer life. That's awesome.
It's free.
Yeah,
absolutely. As a single woman my whole life, I've had to learn that lesson over and over and over again, that he's my provider and I can trust him for that, you know, that he's never let me down my whole life. He's always been there for me. And so that builds my trust in him, you know, every time.
Yeah.
For me.
It took me a while to type it. Sorry, that was going back to your trust question.
Yeah, no, that's good.
For me, first of all, recognizing who God is, knowing his name, in prayer time, that's where you go first. And then from Psalm 52:9, what does he say? Well, thank you.
Mm.
So we spend a lot more time in requests rather than thanks. Mm. So in the order of my prayers, I always want to thank him.
Yeah.
Start making the list.
Yeah. Yeah.
One of the things that spoke to me when I read this is that, especially Psalm 52:9, you can't plead ignorance and not knowing all of God's names and use that as your excuse to not pray and to not be living and not to be that way, because this verse doesn't say a specific name of God. It just says your name, which tells me that I don't have to understand to rely on all of the attributes of God. It's just God. And you know, so often we use ignorance because we don't know all the names for God, but then we have a very shallow prayer life or a very shallow view of who God is. But this verse tells me that's ignorance is not an excuse, because just his name, God, covers it all.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, and I like how you talked about Thanksgiving too, Laura, because I really think Thanksgiving is like the envelope around our prayers. You know, the verse that says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, make your requests known to God with thanksgiving. And we take that with thanksgiving. I don't know, we seem to forget about that bit of the verse, but it's, to me, it's like an envelope that holds all our requests. And it's, there's something, I haven't put my finger on it over these years, but God has been teaching me a lot about Thanksgiving, and there's something powerful in that. So in this verse, he's combining Thanksgiving and God's name together. And I think both of those two are very powerful things.
Well, yeah, there's several Psalms that tell us that you enter into his gates with thanksgiving, right? And then into his courts with praise. Mm. There's a pattern here. I mean, we're getting clear instructions.
Yeah. And coming into knowledge of his names actually increases your thanksgiving.
Yes, it does.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just like an automatic thing. It's like inherent in his names that it will produce thanksgiving. Well, that's what I've found anyway, because like when you come to know God as Jehovah Jireh, like Jan has, here's my provider. He provision, he sees beforehand and prepares something ready for me that I need.
He's Jehovah Roi. He sees.
Yeah. Right? it wells up. Thanksgiving just wells up in you.
Yes, it sure does.
I think the thing I'm the most thankful for is that he has saved me from the fires of hell.
And if you can't start there, you haven't experienced it. Giving thanks. Yeah.
Yeah. 2 Samuel 7. Do as you're promised, that your name will be great forever. And I've latched onto the word great, which is translated as being magnified, which means to grow up, to make great, cause greatness, to be well nurtured and to nourish up. So everything that we have and are is to make his name great. And so the working of God in our lives and in the lives of others should produce in us a cry, glory to God, for his name is great. Yeah. Any thoughts about that? That's what we've been called to do. Make his name great. To magnify his name. Psalm 8, verse 1. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And that word majestic is mighty, noble, splendid, and excellent.
Well, I'm a little slow here, but back to number 3. Do as you promised. If we don't know what the promises of God are, all of them, then how are you going to know what to say to him? Samuel, here it says, do as you promised. He knew what God had promised. And God can't lie. God can't, he can change his mind, because Moses did contend for the people, and God, he was going to put it all on Moses and forget all the rest of them. But Moses reminded him of who he was and how his name would be known throughout the peoples. Remember?
Yeah.
Psalm 8, verse 1. Oh, no, I'll just read that one.
I'm going to go back to that one, too, because I was sitting there. It's funny because great minds think alike, but I was sitting there the same thing. Okay, what do I do? Because I had to go back and reread what the verses were that came before verse 25. So that you can understand that it's, O Lord God, now therefore, O Lord God, the word that you have spoken concerning your servant and his house, confirm it forever and do as you have spoken. So, yeah, I was going to say, I was trying to remember how that all fit in. So I was right there with Laura as I was looking at that one.
I had written down there verse 13 in that same passage. You shall build a house for my name, and I'll establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So the building of the house was for his name. Now, we are his house now.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. We are his house.
Kind of covers all that, doesn't it?
Yeah. We're not just in one place. We're all over the world. We're all part of his house. And so he's building us for his name. Psalm 115, verse 1. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. Yeah. We always, I don't know, in our human nature, want the glory.
Yeah.
It's easy to put ourselves first. And especially when God is unseen and inside us, but our minds go to the seen things first, ourselves, what we have, our achievements, they're all seen things. Give us glory.
Yeah. Hey, I put together a little playlist for us. Y'all probably saw it, of songs that relate to a lot of these things. There's a bunch of songs there. Listen to the song called Not Unto Us, O Lord. And it will lock that in your mind and in your spirit. And you will be walking around singing that all the time. But that's a great declaration. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to your name give glory in everything that you do.
Awesome. Yeah, I saw that playlist. That's so good.
Well, when you think about the world, and this is the exact opposite of what it is in the world today. Because it's all about self. It's all about self-glorification. It's all about me, 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 each person doing what's right in their own eyes. And I will give an example. I had this little boy in kindergarten when I was subbing. He wanted to be at the first of the line. every single time we were going somewhere. I got tired of it. And finally, I looked down at him and I said, the Bible says, he who is first shall be last, and he who is last shall be first. He didn't say a word. He went right back to the end of the line.
That's great.
That's awesome.
We gotta be last, not first.
Well, we've always been taught to make a name for ourselves, haven't we? Like, especially now with the social media, they've been told you've got to have the best images and the amazing words and amazing experiences that you have done, and what have you made, and how much money have you got? It's all about us. Me, me, me.
I heard something recently of a church that the senior guy is no longer the senior guy. He's over like several branches of the church. I'm trying to be careful here. And I don't know if this is true or not. I trust the person who told me that his official title now is brand ambassador.
Oh my.
I know. I mean, that's cool for a business. But the thing is, that is actually, in this situation, quite descriptive of exactly what it is. Mm. I'm hoping it's just a tongue-in-cheek labeling of what his role in functioning is. But even that, yes, Robert said that's pretty common in larger churches. Yeah. And but to be that forthright in the labeling, things would shock me. You know, I don't know.
But is it the brand, like he's supposed to do advertise the brand of the church, or
yes,
God?
Yes. No. They're a little corner of the sandbox.
That's why we should get rid of buildings. And if you didn't have buildings, you wouldn't need, or places, you wouldn't need to build a brand, would you?
You didn't. No, it's, I know, I'm still thinking that one through. But no, isn't that horrible?
Well, that's back to me, 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 doing what's right in my eyes with our quote building church's eyes instead of what's right in God's eyes. So they didn't go ask God if that was a good name for that particular position. Whatever happened to ask God first?
Mm. Yeah. And even if they're just playing around with it, which I'm hoping that's what the thing is, they're just goofing off. But I think the fact that it strikes so close to the reality is what's disconcerting about it.
Yeah. I've got this on my window. It says, O Lord, I wait for you. I desire your fame and reputation to grow. Isaiah 26, verse 8. So whenever I start to do any writing, it's probably backwards, is it? Whenever I start to do any writing, I remind myself that I'm writing for his fame and his reputation to grow, not my own.
Yeah.
Good to remember. Psalm 75, verse 1. We give thanks to you, O God. We give thanks for your name is near. We recount your wondrous deeds. And in the Amplified, it says, your name is near, and they who invoke your name rehearse your wonders. I thought that was quite interesting that his name, to be near, is like a physical thing. His name is near. God is near to us when we see him working wonders in our life. When we invoke the name of God, we are calling on him for help or inspiration as we talk about his wondrous workings in our life. So God's wondrous works in our life show that we're living in God's presence, that he is near. What do you guys think about that verse? Give thanks for your name is near.
Whenever I see these kind of verses, like it always takes me back to Moses, you know, before God, and Moses says, who do I say sent me? And he says, what? I am, which is like the all-encompassing part of his name. And here's Moses standing before the Most High God in some form or fashion. And that, and then I hear Jesus sitting there when Jesus is on earth, he's looking at people saying, hey, the kingdom has come near you today. So everywhere that we are as kingdom vessels, we are what? We are bringing the name of the Lord. If the name of the Lord is near, because I'm near you, not because of anything of who I am, but because of who he is.
Yeah, I think there's a lot more there. I mean, got to ponder that. Like if that is true, which it is, that's awesome that his name is near. And then 1 Samuel 17:45, then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. So David's main weapon against the giant was the name of God, not as five stones and not a weapon of mass destruction, but the name of the Lord of hosts.
Or is the name of the Lord of hosts a weapon of mass destruction? A weapon of mass instruction?
Yes. Yeah. He was talking about something unseen, because in front of Goliath was this teenage kid. And David is saying, with me is the God of the armies of Israel, the Lord of hosts. Like, there's more than what was seen in that time. There's the hosts of the Lord as well. Mm-hmm.
The Elohim.
Yes. Okay, for the last 10 minutes, let's look at the seven ways to use God's names. So there's to run to his name, which was what our key verse is. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs to it and is safe. So we have to really consider, what is our strong tower? What do we run to when life gets tough? And we have to train ourselves to run to him, to his name. Even if it's 10 times a day, whenever we have worry thoughts or in fear. And then we've talked about thanking and praising his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. So that's like a full-time job. We're to praise his name all day long. And then call on his name. Everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. So his name is so powerful that when we call upon it for salvation, he is and answers. Proclaim the name of the Lord. That word proclaim is kara, which means to mention, preach, pronounce, and publish. So I don't think it means that we're to be preachers or all be authors, all be teachers, but just to be able to mention his name. Like if someone says, oh, why are you so happy all the time? You know, things don't get you down. Well, you can mention, oh, well, actually I do have things that get me down, but I pray to God and he helps me. He gives me peace. He's the Prince of Peace. I think our responsibility is just to be able to mention him to others. So it doesn't have to be a big thing. And not mentioning him, I don't know how he feels if we don't mention him.
I think it's nearly like the kind of thing that with every breath we take, we're proclaiming. With every thought, with every action, every deed, it's either going to be a proclamation of the name of the Lord, or it's going to be a proclamation of the name of man. I mean, everything. Yeah.
That's what I was thinking when we don't mention him. Mm. We're not giving him glory. Mm. And that's what we're supposed to be doing all the time.
Mm. Well, we are his lights shining in the darkness. We're supposed to be. Yes. So if someone, you say, what is it about you? Well, then you tell them why. Mm. It's Jesus. It's not me. Mm-hmm. It's his light shining in me. And I give him praise and glory for that.
Mm. I struggle with this because I know, I struggle, maybe it's the environment that I'm in, but you've always been taught not to, what's the word, put people out or make people feel bad and or put your religion onto somebody else and to be tolerant of everybody. Mm-hmm. But then it goes to the point where you don't say anything, and that means that you're putting their position higher than God, really. You know what I mean? Yeah. So my one word this year is courage, to be actually able to speak up for God. Yeah.
Well, I tell you, one thing that has helped me with that right now is just when you're reading the scripture, you know, I'm working through a part of the Gospels right now, and just to see how Jesus did it. When Jesus sat there and looked at the religious rulers that accused him of casting out demons by Beelzebub, he mm-hmm. looked at them and said, and called them a brood of vipers. Mm-hmm. That's pretty bold right there, you know? And then to see how Paul handled things like that, you know, how... And we have these models and these examples right there that it's not a sin to be bold and to call a thing a thing. I can't even use what I would use in the vernacular nowadays because it's so politically incorrect, you know. But to see them as the example, and we know that Jesus did that without sinning. Now, Paul and Peter were like us. They you know, but Jesus calls them a brood of vipers and deals with the truth. This kind of thing, in a very bold and forthright kind of way, and God's perfect timing to say that word.
Mm.
You know, that's what I want.
Well, it got him killed, and it probably would, we wouldn't be very popular.
And he wasn't, and in the process, it saved mankind. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, we haven't been looking at the chat. Robert said, according to the temple priest, the only person the name of the Lord was near was the high priest. Here the writer is trying to open up the paths and view of God. And Laura Ray said, this is what David constantly did to amplify the name of the Lord in his life and actions. What do you mean, Robert, with the only person the name of the Lord was near was the high priest?
Because the high priest could speak the name of the Lord, and only one time a year, and only in the privacy of the Holy of Holies. He was the only one who even knew the name of the Lord.
You know, I think prior to the temple and all the goings on with the temple and the rituals, I actually think that they did say all the different names of the Lord, and especially, well, we don't know how Yod-Heh-Vah-Heh is actually pronounced. We mm-hmm. guess it's Yahweh, but mm-hmm. I think they did, but then it was sort of just taken over, and it was to be only you know, the high priest that was actually say it.
Yeah, I suspect that probably came out of after they received the law, and they said, you learned, okay, you're to keep the name of the Lord holy. Well, then you start living in fear.
Mm.
The easiest way to keep the name holy is not to say the name.
Mm.
And so you start having generations of that kind of thing. And then you have all the scribal insertions of interpretations of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're not using it in vain if you don't say it at all.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And so it became this kind of thing. Well, even today, you know, if you read, get online, read the Jerusalem Post and see how they handled the name of God. And how they print it and how they write it.
Yeah, I've seen people that just do like Christian people that dash. Do G underscore D.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. And that's sort of the idea.
I have an electronic translator that you can tell was written by a, what's the word I'm looking for here?
A Jewish dude.
Yeah, well, in a very conservative Jewish person, because if I type in G-O-D, the O will not type, and it pulls up Yud-Heh-Vah-Heh. If I type in Yud-Heh-Vah-Heh and translate, it gives me G-D. You cannot make this translator say the word, spell the word God. It will not do it. Which tells you it's a very conservative Jewish person who programmed this translator.
Or they say just the Shem, right. Shem being the name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the name. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And okay, I never thought about that. I still don't know what it means. Shem, that's the same name as Noah's son, right?
Shem,
mm-hmm. God is too.
Ham, Shem, and Japheth. And when I read that, I thought, now what's the ramifications of that? So I had to think that through for a while.
Did you come to a conclusion?
No, I'm still thinking. I'm thinking, is there something there? Am I just making something of it? But it's the same word.
Mm. Was he the blessed one? You know, they went different places.
Yeah.
I didn't look it up.
Yeah, no, he's the one that the Semitic people, the Jewish people are from. Japheth is basically all of us that went north, and then the Hamic people line of Cain came out of that, Canaan. Shem was the one that stayed there in the Middle East, Northern Africa and through there. But when I saw that, I thought, I wonder if there's something there of significance. I don't know.
There probably is, because the name is on that people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The Hebrew translation of Shem is name.
And so that's the people of the Lord came from that line. So that is significant enough of itself right there.
That is so cool.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, just the last couple of things I've got there to use his name is to trust his name. Let him who walks in the darkness, who has no light, trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. It's from Isaiah 50. And then love his name, your name and remembrance are the desire of my soul. Honor his name. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Was what we talked about before. I've got there one of the tactics of the enemy is to devalue God's name, and so many people use it as a swear word. And they don't use Allah or Buddha as swear words, just God.
That's always been the most interesting thing. You don't hear anybody cussing Buddha.
Yeah.
You know, why is that?
Well, the enemy knows that the name of God is powerful.
I think that's it. And I think that even the people who don't know God, it's an acknowledgement of the true source of life and the true source of power, that all the other ones are false gods.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, the ignorance of people is unbelievable in this day and time. I was in a third grade class, and there was somebody saying OMG, and I put a stop to that immediately. And I told them why. And the little girl came to me and she said, I'm sorry, I didn't know.
Isn't that great? Sad and great. I've had to share it with adults in church. That would sit there when I grew up, everybody would say dad gum. I've shared this with the Bible study before. I said, guys, all that is a transliteration of God damn.
Mm-hmm.
Think this through.
Let your yes be yes and your no be no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why the need for having to vocalize something?
Yeah. Okay. Well, time is up. I actually like that this number six. Probably end on that, because number seven is a little bit of a downer. Your name and remembrance are the desire of our soul. And desire in Hebrew means longing, delight, satisfaction. And it's actually also a strong sigh. So the questions are, when you think and ponder God, his son Jesus, and his spirit, does it give you delight? Do you long to find out more? And do you long to spend time getting to know God? He is your strong sigh. Your desire.
So is it like a strong sigh of satisfaction and fulfillment? Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
And longing. I think it's more longing, you know.
Oh, and long.
Yeah. Okay. That's number one, week one.
Oh, thank you so much, Rachel. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, well, let's pray together. Father, we thank you for you and who you are, and we give you thanks. Lord, we give you thanks for all that you have done, for what you're doing, and for what is yet to come that we don't know about, but you do. Lord, I thank you especially for Rachel, how you've moved upon her heart just through the months and years here to bring these truths together and to share with us through the written word, to share with us through just leading right now and speaking. And Lord, your spirit through her spirit to us. I don't know about everybody else, but Lord, there's more being imparted within the spirit right there, even than within the words. And I praise you for that. And thank you for that. And what is it, Lord, that you're wanting to do with each one of us to do the light things with each one of us in the way that you've designed for each one? Lord, we're just open to it, and we want whatever you want. So Father, just continue to give us more insight into your name, and then show us how to live out that name. Lord, literally with every breath that we take, with every thought that we have, and that, Lord, as we do this, that it will be to the praise and the glory of you and you alone, and it will bring the multitudes into your kingdom. Father, we love you and we bless you, and we do thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Rachel, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Rachel.
Yeah, and bless you. And
yes,
hey, Rachel. Thank you. Rachel, hang around here a second. I want to try something. Okay. Can you make me the host again? Can I have my room back? No.
I thought you already were the host. Should we stop recording? How do I stop recording?